Belinda and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of Ming and Flo Fight for the Future, Girls Who Changed the World, Book 1, written by Jackie French and read by Edwina Wren. A welcome to country. I write my books on Durga land of the Yuan nation. I give my love and gratitude to elders past who created the living larder and the beauty of my home country. My love, respect, and endless admiration to the elders of today who give their knowledge so generously and profoundly to us all. And my love and confidence in all the elders of the future. J.F. Men must work and women must weep is a quote from the poem The Three Fishes by English poet, novelist and priest Charles Kingsley in 1851. The first pub we come to, there we'll have a spree, and everyone who comes along, it's come and drink with me. Lyrics from the traditional Australian ballad Click Go the Shears. The dedication reads, To Lisa, who changes the world in the thousand ways of a brilliant editor, and to Jack and Tom, always. Prologue. Ming gazed at the tiger. Its blood-stained teeth grinned at her. She lifted her skirts to run, but there was no escape. Of all the stupid things she'd ever done, this was the worst, and all because of goat droppings. Chapter 1. The Daughter of Time. The deck lurched as the wrecked ship sank.
We need to use the goat droppings, sir, gasped Jonathan.
Captain Cook stared at the young man.
Goat droppings?
Down in the hold, sailors screamed as the water rose. Ming Qong could feel the bite of the coral that had shattered the Endeavour on the Great Barrier Reef. She could even smell the goat droppings. If only she were there.
The dry droppings absorbed water to seal the sail to the damaged hull so Captain Cook could get the ship to shore, droned Mr. Bawes. The class snickered at the word droppings, except for Kayla, who was texting under the desk, and Karuna trying to balance a pen on his nose. Antoine, who was reading the last page of the textbook, again. Ming sighed. Mr. Bawes had a rare talent. Exciting history became dull as soon as he opened his mouth.
Jonathan Monkhouse changed history, said Mr. Bawes, with no sign of interest at all. Without him, Cook would have never returned to England, there wouldn't have been a British colony at Sydney Cove or today's Australia. Now, if you'll turn to page 45.
Ming's hand shot up before she'd realised it.
Sir, why don't we ever learn about girls who changed history? I mean, girls are changing the world right now, like Greta Thunberg and all the girls demonstrating and inventing. Where were girls at all the important times in the past?
It's a very good question, said Mr. Bawes, which was what teachers said instead of, can we just get this lesson over with? Can anyone suggest a girl who changed the world? Yes, Tuan.
Be quiet, Tuan, thought Ming, exasperated. Brothers, especially twin brothers, especially Tuan, who thought he knew everything about history just because they'd both read all Dad's textbooks from when he did history as well as engineering at uni.
Tuan liked the kind of movies where the pirates wore shiny leather boots. Pirates never wore shiny boots at sea because they'd have slid off the deck in the sloppy droppings of the animals ships had to take to sea just so people could survive. Ming imagined Tuan sliding off the deck in sloppy goat droppings. Tuan flashed a grin at Ming.
It's a stupid question, sir. Girls couldn't change the world back then. Women didn't even get the vote till last century. Girls in the past stayed at home or were servants or dairy maids and stuff.
This is revenge, thought Ming.
Last night she'd caught Tuan watching that movie where the Americans captured the German Enigma code machine months before the US entered World War II. And he hadn't even noticed they got it wrong till Ming had pointed it out to everyone in the boarding house. Mr. Bors nodded absent-mindedly.
Exactly. Now everyone turn to page 45.
Tuan sent Ming another grin. The same grin she sometimes saw in the mirror. Just like she and Tuan both had Dad's Chinese-Vietnamese face shape and hair, but blue eyes that had probably come from some Viking ancestor of Mum's. Not that their mum had been around long enough to ask her. Ming gazed around. Wasn't anyone going to come up with a suggestion? But the class were turning to page 45, except for Kayla, who was still texting, and Karuna, who'd decided to balance his history book on his head. And the problem was, Tuan was probably right. Even if he had told her to hush last week when she tried to tell the rest of the boarding house how Mel Gibson shouldn't have worn a tartan kilt in Braveheart because tartan kilts hadn't even been invented. And blue face painting had gone out of fashion more than 1,000 years before, not to mention the white car in the background of one of the battles. How could teachers allow schools to show movies that got stuff wrong like that? Boarding school was boring school. Except for Tuan, her most interesting friends were all in books and lived at least 100 years ago. Ming shut her eyes again, trying to let the whole of time seep through her mind. She could almost smell the centuries. Oh, there were heroines and lots of queens, but had any one of them really entirely changed the world? And they'd all been a lot older than her. She focused as hard as she could. She had to find at least one girl who'd changed the world.
"Brothers," said someone with loathing just behind her.
"Tuan's okay," said Ming absent-mindedly. At least Tuan didn't call her Princess Nerd. She blinked. Who'd said that? Suddenly she realised the class was silent. No scuffling shoes, no droning voice. Even the traffic no longer muttered in the distance. Kayla's fingers had stopped and the book toppling from Karuna's head seemed suspended forever. Tuan was studying page 45, even though he knew what was on it just as well as Ming did. Ming looked around. The woman sitting on the windowsill just behind her seemed tall, though she wasn't, and old and young, and both close and very far away. Her skin seemed more gold than tan, and she wore a long purple garment and purple joggers and held a mauve umbrella over her long silver hair. And Ming knew her, even though they'd never met before. This woman had been with her, sensed but not seen, every time Ming imagined the past.
"Your history?"
"What am I saying?" she thought desperately. "This couldn't be happening."
"History's my brother," the silver-haired woman sighed. "He's okay too, just a bit too sure of himself. It's not his fault you humans only tell his side of the past." "I'm her story."
Ming shook her head. Had her brain broken?
"I don't understand."
Herstory looked annoyed.
"Most people don't. Most people don't even see me. At least you can."
Ming stared as the figure in the window crossed her legs in their purple joggers. This was no hallucination. "What do you mean, his side of the past?"
"Think about it. Ancient humans faced mammoths armed with bone-tipped spears, and the women hunted with the men," said Herstory enthusiastically. "People sailed on flimsy rafts to new continents or islands. And if there hadn't been women on those rafts, there'd have been no new humans. Who do you think baked their first bread? Bred wild red jungle fowl to become tame chickens? And we're talking girls too, not just women.
because through most of human past, women and girls worked together just like boys learned from the men.
Then why aren't girls in the history books?
Did you hear what you just said? His story. We've had a long period of time in the most powerful parts of the world where men have controlled the way the world worked. Men have been the rulers, the property owners. Men wrote the history books, and they mostly wrote them to please kings or generals or male politicians.
You mean they lied? People who lied about the past deserve to be trodden on by cockroaches.
Herstory shook her head, making her umbrella wobble. No, they mostly just told only part of the truth. The bits they thought mattered. His story, not mine.
Ming glanced around the silent class, then back at the figure on the windowsill. Why are you here?
Herstory looked amused. I'm always here.
Why have you appeared now, then?
Because you called me.
But I didn't. Ming hesitated. Maybe I did.
You long to see a girl in the past change the world.
Suddenly, Ming realized she did, more than anything she could think of. Can you show me that?
Of course. On one condition.
Ming tried not to bounce up to the ceiling with excitement.
Anything, she said enthusiastically. You make a note of what you see. Everything you see that has been left out of all the history books you've read. All the her story that's been ignored. You write it down, all of it. Then you show it to everyone, including your brother. And I can show it to mine.
Of course. I'll write about everything. Ming could just imagine Tuan's face when she told him where she'd been. This would be a billion times better than telling him about Braveheart's fake kilt. What happened in the past explained the present. It mattered. But how do I prove that I've actually seen the past?
You don't. But women's stories are there, waiting to be found in old diaries, in letters, even sometimes in newspapers. Once you've seen the past, you'll know what to look for. Write it as an essay, even as a story, just as long as people know that the things that happened in it were true.
Herstory grinned.
Any other questions?
Why the joggers?
Sometimes time goes fast.
And the umbrella?
It's going to rain sometime.
Ah, yes, here it is.
Herstory held her hand out the window to catch raindrops that scattered in a brief sunlit shower. She looked back at Ming, the drops in a small blue glowing pile in her hand.
Do you truly want to see the past?
Of course.
You're not frightened by what you might see. The past isn't always pretty.
I'm not worried. Crocodiles, sword fights, the spears of advancing armies. Ming could face them all. She and Tuan had studied judo since they were 7. When other kids had been playing video games, they'd been bushwalking with Dad. And due to her education, she'd know more than anyone she met back in the past. That had to help.
You should be worried. The past is uncomfortable. Even the best of times lacked things like phones, or air conditioning, or safety from wolves or saber-toothed tigers, dentists. Queen Elizabeth's rotting teeth ached most of her life.
Queen Elizabeth was wonderful, though she'd been almost old when she led England against the invading Spanish, banished from court or imprisoned when she'd been a girl.
Queen Elizabeth still didn't have a dentist.
Herstory looked down at the raindrops in her hand, then poured most of them out. The drops shone as they hit the ground, then evaporated. Herstory looked back at Ming.
These will give you 42 days in the past to watch a girl change the world. You'll see, but not touch. No one will hear you or see you either.
What?
Ming stared at her.
No, I want to be in the past. I want to be part of it. Watching things happen wouldn't be much better than a movie. More accurate, but boring too, because she'd have to watch people sleeping or cutting their toenails.
Herstory shook her head. It's too dangerous.
I can look after myself.
Herstory looked amused again.
Against exploding volcanoes? Enemy bombs?
Then send me where there aren't any volcanoes or enemy bombs. Please, I want to be a girl who changes the world.
Excitement trickled through her.
She'd be a princess or an explorer. She could invent something incredible.
I didn't just mean there'd be danger to you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.